Well, good morning. Welcome back to our city chapel on this pretty sunny-ish day. It's good to see all of you here, and I hope we'll see you all next door after service for our parish annual meeting. That should be expedited and quick this year as we try to limit our exposure to one another in this time of COVID. Anyways, welcome once again, and welcome to our online visitors and guests and members as well. Our service this morning begins in your service leaflet on this third Sunday after the Epiphany. Please stand. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be the kingdom, and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Give us grace, O Lord, to answer readily the call of our Savior Jesus Christ and proclaim to all people the good news of his salvation, that we and the whole church may perceive the glory of his marvelous works, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for our readings.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. I mean, brothers and sisters, the appointed time has grown short. From now on, let even those who have wives be as though they had none, and those who mourn as though they were not mourning, and those who rejoice as though they were not rejoicing, and those who buy as though they had no possessions, and those who deal with the world as though they had no dealings with it. For the present form of this world is passing away. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read the psalm responsively by the half verse. For God alone, my soul in silence waits.
Truly, there is my hope.
God alone is my rock and my salvation.
My stronghold, so that I shall not be shaken.
In God is my safety and my honor.
God is my strong rock and my refuge.
Put your trust in God always, O people.
Pour out your hearts before the one who is our refuge.
Though the high degree are but a fleeting breath.
Even those of low estate cannot do trust it.
On the scales they are lighter than a breath.
All of them together.
No trust in extortion, in robbery take no empty pride.
Though wealth increase, set not your heart upon it.
God has spoken once, twice have I heard it.
That power belongs to God.
Steadfast love is yours, O God.
For you repay everyone according to their deeds.
Stand if you are able. This is the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news. As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated.
I speak to you now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, last week, we as a people, no matter our political stripe, were once again inspired by the awe and majesty of our country's tradition of inaugurating new presidents and vice presidents out of doors on cold January days in Washington, D.C. The purpose of such an event is to let our country and the world know something has changed. Something has a new start. And this great land of ours has passed the torch once again in peaceful and prayerful manner. The term inauguration is rarely in our culture, if ever, used in our day-to-day language, except for this one, let's say, 3-4 year commemoration. However, that word, inauguration, can be defined as the formal beginning or initiation of any movement, course of action, as in the inauguration of a new system, a new condition. Using that definition, all of us sitting here today have likely experienced our own inaugurations when we were baptized. We were inaugurated in our baptism into Christ's one holy Catholic and apostolic church, forever, as the prayer book states. Many of our youth will be inaugurated this year in the sacramental rite we call confirmation on the 27th of June. Adults who also wish to more fully join this church, to be inaugurated into this church family, can come and see me, and we will set something up so you can be inaugurated on that day of June 27th. At our baptisms, all of us are marked as a turning point, either of our own choosing or on our behalf by our parents and our godparents. We were inaugurated in our baptisms into the life of the church forever in the sacrament of baptism. Just as presidential inaugurations are outward and visible signs of change, change to the world, so are our baptisms. Try to take these off. Outward and visible signs of our change of hearts, of God's grace in our lives as we learn to follow and to journey with Christ. There was once an Episcopalian woman who decided she wanted to see the USA from one end to the other. So she flew out to San Diego, California, rented a car, and planned her journey to drive home to New England. On her way, she decided that she would visit a different Episcopal church every Sunday. When she visited her first church, which happened to be in San Diego, it was a large parish in the heart of San Diego. She was surprised, though, when she walked into the narthex of that grand church to find gold-painted telephone there in the narthex. Next to it was a sign that read, "3 minutes for $10,000." Now, no one took the time to speak with our friend that day. The priests all seemed busy with many congregants gathered close for coffee and conversation served in the narthex near that gold phone. She left that day thinking this must be some big city stunt. She traveled on, and then soon it was already Sunday morning again. She was somewhere in the Texas Panhandle by this time. And she went to an adorable little church there that made her think of that old song, The Little Brown Church in the Vale. Much to her surprise, when she walked in, there was another gold phone in the narthex. The same sign, $10,000 for 3 minutes. At this parish, she was able to approach the rector, and she asked, "What exactly is that phone for?" He replied, "Well, you know, it's a direct line to God." "Oh," she said, a bit stunned, "I'll remember that. Well, maybe I can raise $10,000 someday and come back." Well, next she went north, heading into southern Ohio, and there was another sweet chapel-sized Episcopal church, believe it or not, with another gold phone in the same sign, $10,000 for 3 minutes. There was no coffee hour here, so off she went, veering northeast towards home. The next Sunday, she was back home, back in her own parish. And short enough, while she was gone that month, there was another gold phone. "Where did that come from?" she thought. She was reminded of her traveling days and each of the gold phones she'd seen over those Sundays. She read the sign at her own church and was surprised to see that it said 3 minutes for 50 cents. She couldn't believe her eyes. After coffee hour, she approached her rector and asked him, "Well, Father, why does our phone only cost 50 cents to use?" "Well," replied the rector, "you see, here at St. Swithin's, a direct call to God is a local call." St. Swithin's, after that, became home to our weary traveler in new ways, and it was now appreciated more than ever. Here, she thought, we can be in touch with God so very easily without traveling across the country or even across the town. And Jesus didn't journey far to find his disciples. And when he found each of them, they took his local call. And each followed along as his faithful but sometimes bumbling sidekicks. Jesus inaugurated their ministry that day with his invitation, somehow sensing or perceiving exactly the men and probably a few women whom he wanted to keep close at hand. There's another equally important inauguration that I'd like to be sure each of you know about this morning. This inauguration began long before there was ever a United States of America, long before anyone ever heard of the concept of a democracy or a telephone or a television. This inauguration began on Sunday morning about 2,000 years ago. This inauguration began with another outward and visible sign, this time not with water or with gold phones or even prayer books. This inauguration began with fire on the heads of Jesus' bumbling disciples as they were locked in that rented upper room, all scared, once again waiting on Jesus to come and call them. The famous New Testament theologian C.H. Dodd used to speak of a partially inaugurated or partially realized kingdom of God. That means that when Jesus died, was resurrected, and ascended, when the Holy Spirit was found in a new way, those bumbling disciples of Jesus were no longer quite so bumbling. The good news for all of us is that Jesus' reign, God's heavenly kingdom, has indeed begun, has been partially realized right here, right now. We are in God's kingdom now, awaiting the second realization, the final inauguration of Jesus' reign. It means we have have nothing to fear, nothing to worry about. God is there working in our hearts, our minds, and our souls each and every day. But that being said, there are moments of doubt, moments of uncertainty that we have to contend with on this side of the fully realized, fully inaugurated kingdom of God, this side of heaven, if you will. There was once a man who couldn't seem to shake the blues. No matter how hard he tried, he still felt sadness more than joyfulness. Finally, he decided he was going to go see a counselor about why he couldn't shake all of the darkness he felt each day. He carefully explained the situation to the counselor, and the counselor listened intently, but just then the counselor glanced out the window, and he called the man over to the window and said, "Look over there, pointing. The circus is in town. Maybe you just need to go watch the clowns. There is a clown called Rosario who is just hilarious. He will have you inside splitting the laughter in no time. Rosario will take your mind off your troubles." Well, the man thanked the doctor for his time, and as he walked out of the office, he handed the man his business card and left the building. The counselor looked at the card. The card read, "Rosario, the clown, world-famous man of many laughs." Even though he knew how to make others laugh, Rosario the clown could not lift his own spirits. Sometimes we have to ask ourselves, what will it take for my spirit to be lifted? What can I do for myself to connect to the life-giving spirit those disciples found in that upper room on a Pentecost day so long ago? Well, first of all, if you are truly depressed, please go see a healthcare professional. No one can blame anyone for being depressed in the midst of a pandemic, let alone everything else we have witnessed and experienced in that year of 2020. But if you are just wondering, where does my faith meet my attitude towards these rough years of life? And it's time to get back here, back to church, back to the basics, whether you're online or in person. Have I got a deal for you? Come back here, either in person or online, each Sunday in 2021, and learn about the book Jesus read, the book that cheered his soul. That's right, the Old and New Testaments of the Bible. Our new parish-wide small group Bible study called The Story will be inaugurated 1 week from today. We'll be going through an abridged reading of the entire story, through the ups and downs, the goods, the bads, the uglies, the scripture, Old and New Testaments over the coming year together. What is that old saying? Do you remember it? Hindsight is 20/20. Well, the Bible is full of hindsights as we learn how the Israelites survived plagues, famines, floods. The Bible is about how God's own people requested a king and then found out that maybe it was not what they were looking for. So come and explore what happens when God offers the final solution to humanity's wandering ways in the life of his son, Jesus. In this time of ongoing waiting for vaccines, protecting ourselves from an enemy we can't see, and enduring death and destruction, sometimes of what we hold most dear, the Bible is where we can find solace and comfort. Knowing for certain we are not in unique times, we are only in the continuation of a faith that was handed down and then handed to us by those who came before us and even those who came before Jesus. Let's plan to re-inaugurate our faith this year of 2021. And then let's go out and call disciples of all generations and of all nations, inaugurating them in the vows of holy baptism, now and forever. Amen. Now, standing as you are able, let us confirm the words of our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The prayers of the people are according to Form 2 and are in your service leaflet. I ask your prayers for God's people throughout the world, for our presiding bishop, Michael, and our bishop diocesan, Russell, for this gathering, and for all ministers and people, pray for the church. I ask for prayers for peace, for goodwill among nations, and for the well-being of all people. Pray for justice and peace. I ask you prayers for the poor, the sick, the hungry, the oppressed, and those in prison. Pray for those in any need or trouble. I ask you prayers for all who seek God or a deeper knowledge of him. Pray that they may find and be found by him. I ask you prayers for the departed. Pray for those who have died, especially Ian. I ask for thanksgivings for those celebrating birthdays this week, especially Patsy, Joe, Elizabeth, Emery, Tom, and Julia. Let us pray for the needs of others, especially Sheila, Russell, Angie, Doug, Arthur, Dolores, Wyatt, Doug, Tom, Jay, Nicole, Susan, Joyce, Ronnie, Denison, the family of Graham Wilker, the family of Jim D'Amico, the family of Leslie Coppola, the family of Dee Kaiser, Amanda, Karen, the family of Ian Spence, and all those in need of prayer during this pandemic. Are there others?
The Henderson family.
We also pray for those in our long-term prayer list, especially Margaret, Ruth, John, Donna, Kristen, Chuck, Keith, Ralph, Martha, Adrian, Ward and Gladys, Will, Kermit, Ruby, Ivan, Rosella, Dean, Briar, Donald, Janet, Jean, Tom, the Levesque family, and Brian. Are there others? We pray for all first responders and all in the armed forces and for their families, especially Joe, Tim, Christopher, Brewer, Lewis, Patrick, Brandon, Ashland, Sarah Grace, Bernie, John, Cody, Hunter, Bill, Joey, and all in harm's way. Are there others? In the diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray for our fellow parish of St. Peter's in Bon Secours. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the dioceses of Lokoja in Nigeria and St. Mark the Evangelist in South Africa. We pray for the people affected by hurricanes and by all natural disasters. Praise God for those in every generation in whom Christ has been honored. Pray that we may have grace to glorify Christ in our own day. Sanctify, O Lord, those whom you have called to the study and practice of the arts of healing and to the prevention of disease and pain. Strengthen, by your life-giving spirit, doctors, nurses, and all who care for the sick, that by their ministries the health of the community may be promoted and your creation glorified. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Now let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen. Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And
also, please exchange a sign of God's peace with your neighbor and come to your loved ones. Well, please be seated for a few moments. And before I forget, Mr. Mark Ryan back there, he is our usher today. And see, Mark, he has a source for vaccinations in Mobile. And he will hook you up with a clinic over there that has some vaccines. So look to our usher for some source to get vaccinated if you haven't already done so. Just want to avail you all of that opportunity. Today, again, immediately after the service, we will all graduate over to the parish hall, and there we will have our parish annual meeting. More the merrier. We're going to try and expedite it this year, just as we've been expediting worship all year, so that we're not in each other's midst too long, and kind of go from there. But I hope you can join us for that. Not going to say much more about the story, except that it really does start next week. There's a sign-up sheet right out of here by the library, and we're going to have four groups, and just put your preferences down, and I'll get you signed up. Now, each of you got a little flyer there, a little colored flyer that Jan ran off on her home printer, and that is how you will access the videos. So you will, unless you're at the Wednesday group, you will access the videos from home before the class, and then that leads to a lot of discussion. There in the center is a picture of Randy Frazee. He is the pastor that leads us through these discussions and does such a beautiful job of sharing the scripture and bringing it to life for us as we walk through the study. We'll take off all summer long, we'll take off holidays, but basically you'll be hearing more about those 31 chapters in the story, not only from this pulpit, but in your small groups if you choose to sign up. I'm trying to course, it's kind of like there's two tables here. So there's one here behind me, one here in front of Jan. You two will come up and commune on your own. And as soon as they go back, Jan will wipe that off. And then Lynn, you'll come up and commune on your own, and so on and so forth. Please don't congregate in the aisle and stand there, but please wait until the communion rail is empty and wiped down before you approach the rail. And I know we have quite a few folks over in Parish Hall today, so I'm going to invite them to line up by family unit in a safe distance here in this hallway, and let's let all of them commune before those of us in the chapel commune today, just so that they can come in this door over here and go out that door over there and back to Parish Hall, where we'll all gather after the service today. We'll walk in love as Christ loved us and offered himself as sacrifice, pure and holy. Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord, our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Because of the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of your glory in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the heights. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the heights. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people. in your word, spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word, made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with Simon, Andrew, James, John, and Paul, we and all your saints may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. 5 of your service leaf, your page 366, if you're following along at home in your prayer books. Standing, kneeling, or sitting as you prefer, let us pray together as Christ's family. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you've given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. May Christ, the Son of God, be manifest in you, that your light may be a light to the world, and the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you this day, and remain with you forever. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.